With record low interest rates over the past few years, millennials have been taking on increasing amounts of debt to buy homes and fund education. And they're now in a position where many have to decide between using cash flow to pay down their debt or save for retirement. Joining us now is Dilys D'Cruz, Vice President and Head of Wealth Management at Meridian Credit Union, and Jordan Damiani, a Senior Wealth Advisor. You're both here to talk about the millennial concept of retirement. So welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you.
Thanks for having us.
So retirement is not something that is a common concern or focus for millennials, right?
No. And so, you know what? I thought, why not bring in a millennial to talk about that? So we have a senior wealth advisor, Jordan, who is
a millennial.
Yeah. So we're going to give you the millennial perspective right from the horse's mouth.
Yeah. Right? Now, a lot of people are confused about the age of millennials.
Oh, darn, are you going to ask me that?
I am, because, I mean, there's a distinct difference. But right now, they say, because there's Generation X, which is sort of what I am, but millennials is generally born 1981 to 1996.
Right.
So I still think of millennials as you know, my kids. But in actual fact, if you were born in 1981, maybe you should be thinking about what you're doing.
On the higher end, right?
On the higher end. So those are the age ranges. And why? Like, when did you start thinking about retirement?
You know what? So the funny thing is, and in terms of the millennials that I ask and myself, we don't think about it, right? So, you know, my day-to-day is doing financial planning and thinking about retirement for the members that I work with. Mm-hmm. But collectively as millennials, you know, we're not thinking about something that's 30 years away. You know, and actually just even in the break room, I had the conversation and, you know, picked people's brains and said, hey, you know, you're millennials. Do you think about retirement? Nope. So, you know, from that perspective, I think it's important to even frame it as, you know, financial security, you know. So I look at it in a different sense that if I make good financial decisions, you know, year by year, I'm going to put myself in a good position, you know, whether I'm 50, 55 or 60 and, you know, really contemplating, okay, when do I really want to retire? And, you know, you made the comment just about, you know, record levels of debt that millennials are taking on. Well, if you're thinking about buying a house, you don't have job security, you know, it's going to be really difficult to kind of ponder, well, when do I want to stop working when maybe you haven't even got your full-time job yet?
We were just talking about that.
Yeah.
And
I
said, I don't even think about retirement.
So it's
I should think about it.
But it's funny because we do come from the generation of, I did start saving for an RSP right when I started working.
Wow. Automatic deduction off the paycheck.
Yes. We were the generation of what if this happens? What if that happens? What if you lose your job? Yeah. What if you break your leg? What if, and so why is that you don't think about it? Do you think it'll just sort itself out?
Well, one of the things I was going to say before you jump in is just also we had pension plans, right? And so I remember when I first started working, it was just you automatically go into the pension plan and that was what you did. And I think you'll talk to this as well. Millennials may not have that option depending on you know, where they're working.
Which makes it even more imperative that they start saving.
Yeah, absolutely. So I definitely contribute very diligently to RSP's tax-free savings account. And certainly even the millennial members that I work with do as well. I think it's just more conceptual in terms of saying, you know, everyone knows they have to save, you know, for a rainy day. I think for some it's easier than others. You know, imagine you're just getting out of university and, you know, you got to put get your foot in the door. Maybe it's, you know, temp work or an internship and you're probably not even getting paid anything meaningful or at all. Right.
So well, it's what they call a gig economy.
Right.
Right? A lot of people are on contracts, on day rates. There are no benefits. There are no paid vacations. So and I'm just looking at resumes that come across my desk. I'm like, wow, you know, it used to be you never admitted that you only had a job that lasted a year or less. And now it's almost expected.
Mm-hmm. It's pretty standard. But I mean, in an environment where 46% of Canadians feel they're like maybe $200 or less away from insolvency, it seems odd.
Yeah, and you know what? And that's a pretty shocking, you know, statistic.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I think a lot of the advice that millennials can follow is going to be applicable to baby boomers or you know, other demographics as well. And, you know, you had made the comment about, you know, paying yourself first. So I think one of the easiest things that you can do you know, is when you do, you know, get that paycheck, you know, earmark some of that for savings, you know, and do it pre-authorized so it's out of sight, out of mind. You know, you're not thinking about it. And, you know, there certainly are some steps, you know, that people can follow to you know, really get themselves in better shape, you know, financially. And, you know, usually what I advocate is, you know, kind of get organized. That's the first step, you know, find out, you know, do I owe anything? You know, do I owe anything on credit cards? Because those tend to be the most punitive, you know.
And doesn't help your credit rating either.
Yeah, well, absolutely. Carrying a balance on some of the store cards can be 28%. You know, even a typical credit card is 20. So, you know, one of the comments I hear the most from millennials, and this applies to every demographic, is there is no financial literacy in Canada. I'm not taught this in school. You know, they're certainly there to offer, you know, credit cards, but they're really not there to tell us how to use them responsibly. And I think that's the challenge. So the whole concept of taking inventory, well, do I owe anything? You know, do I have savings? You know, in some cases, if you have a mortgage, what is the payment? How long is my mortgage amortized for? You know, those are really some important things you can start with. And, you know, from a personal finance perspective, I always recommend, especially if people have a challenge saving, because oftentimes you'll hear, well, I don't have any money to save. Well, you know, what you can do is track your spending, right? So I would say everyone's usually running their spending through a Visa or a debit card. Well, you know, add up your last 6 months of statements and
see where you're overdoing it.
Download that stuff. I mean, now it's so easy. You download it into an Excel spreadsheet and sort, and then you can figure out exactly.
That's if you can figure out an Excel spreadsheet.
Okay. I'm not very good on Excel, but and it's also not something that people like to do, to track their.
Yeah, so I was actually going to say, because you were talking about this, but that's when an advisor comes into play, because it's easier said than done to do all of this. And we've talked about it a lot. That's what actually Jordan would sit down and do with somebody, to kind of ask you those questions and walk you through and help you with a budget, and to kind of say, yeah, you actually can afford to save, right?
Yeah, and there's a couple strategies, right, that we can employ. So I'm in the same boat. I hate keeping track of every small little detail. You know, if I go and buy a cup of coffee, and I'm not putting that in a notebook, I'm not tracking that, right? So part of the reason why I'd say, you know, if you feel like you have difficulty saving, you know, you kind of have to know where your money's going, you know, to see, is there any ability to, you know, carve out something that you could effectively save? So that's where, to Dilys's point, you know, if you have the ability, go online, print out the last 6 months of your credit card statements and debit card statement, and then you can see, well, how much am I spending on restaurants every month? You know, it might be $500 spent eating out. Well, that's $6,000 a year. And certainly, I think the millennial experience to relate to that is, well, I don't want to miss out. And I think it's, you know, I use the term substitution.
I was going to talk to you about that, because it seems that millennials are very much more into experiences, experiential gifts and doing things. And how does, as opposed to, you know, amassing wealth or buying a house. So how do you balance this desire to experience the world and all it has to offer and have a future in it?
Yeah, and I think there's a really good strategy. So we kind of talk about, when you keep track of every little, you know, dollar that goes out, I would kind of term that bottom-up, you know, saving. So top-down saving, I think, is what I do and is what tends to be effective for everybody, is, you know, prioritize the order of your spending. So everyone knows, okay, if I have bills, like a utility bill or mortgage, that has to be paid. But what people often do, and I find it's a little bit of a mistake, is, you know, spend and then say, okay, if I got money left over, I'll save that. So treat your savings like a bill, you know, and say, hey, maybe $100, $200 or, you know, relative to your income, whatever people can afford. Well, as soon as I get paid, that's going to come out and go into a savings vehicle, you know, whether that's the RSP or tax-free savings account. And then, you know, hey, I'm taking care of that piece. And this is where the planning is so important, is to find out, well, hey, over a, you know, my, you know, lifetime prior to retirement, what will that equate to? Am I on track effectively to do that, right? Yeah. And then spend what's left over, right? So then you're not missing out.
I was going to say, and I do this too, right? I use automatic transfers all the time. I use several accounts. I have automatic money, you know, right, going whenever I get paid right in. So there's all these little tips and tactics that you can do so that you don't feel it, right? And you do pay yourself first.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess it must be hard for millennials, who are going to live longer than anybody, certainly us, apparently, because they're eating so healthy and working out, right? But it must be a lot of stress knowing that you don't have a defined pension and your job will morph into no job, and you'll
be acquiring another skill set, maybe.
Yeah, I think the discipline is so important, right? So that's why if you don't have a pension, you know, your retirement is in your hands effectively, and you've got to be the one to save for that. So that's why the whole concept of paying yourself first, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. over your lifetime, just every paycheck, save a little bit of that. And that'll go a long way.
Okay, yeah. So where can people go to learn more and connect with an advisor?
So check out our website, www.meridiancu.ca, and we have all our advisors there. Find a location and advisor near you.
Excellent. Yeah. And they could find you, Jordan Damiani.
Yes.
Thank you. And Dilys D'Cruz, both from Meridian Credit Union, for coming in and telling us all the news that we need to know. Thank you.
Thank you.